Good evening. Tonight, in a specially extended TVI, we examine the price of the principles involved in the Falklands crisis. It's the end of a day in which there appeared to be hopes of a new peace initiative, but those hopes were dashed a few minutes ago. In a Foreign Office statement, Foreign Secretary Francis Pim said that the plan dubbed the Peruvian peace plan had collapsed. He said, "I am deeply disappointed that Argentinian intransigence has once again frustrated a constructive initiative." He went on to say that had the Argentinians accepted, there might have been a ceasefire by 5 o'clock tomorrow. So once again, the mood is gloomy. And in public opinion polls today, we checked what the public thought. Was it worth losing lives to maintain the principle that aggression shouldn't pay? 55% said yes, 38% said no. However, Julian Manyon's report from Buenos Aires offers little hope. As far as he can see, attitudes are hardening towards their cause. This is his report by satellite.
A bullet-scarred Union Jack is the latest image chosen by the government's propagandists to encourage their people in the confrontation with Britain. 10,000 of these posters were printed this week, and by chance they were distributed on the day the Sheffield was sunk. On the basis of that thinking, many Argentines believe that the Royal Navy is on the run. And the poster itself is now a symbol of why a compromise settlement is still so difficult. It calls, quite simply, for a fight to the death. Death is what has now made this conflict so hard to stop. Last Sunday, Buenos Aires saw its first military funeral since the crisis began. The dead man was an Air Force colonel killed last week in a helicopter crash, along with nine of his men. The crash was accidental, but was linked in people's minds to the conflict with Britain, as the crewmen were being trained for imminent action when they died. We now know that the last post will have to sound many more times before this crisis is ended. Argentina's military chiefs can count their dead in dozens, if not in hundreds, men who have died on the Falklands or in the icy seas where the cruiser General Belgrano went down. But confidence has been massively boosted by the sinking of the Sheffield, and there's no sign that the military establishment is pressing for a compromise solution. Argentina's fate in this crisis is now in the hands of men like Colonel Bernardo Menendez, a key figure inside the military government. In his own blunt way, he told me about Argentina's position on negotiations after the latest round of fighting.
The Argentinian government has been more than clear on this point. The Argentinian government has stated that Argentinian sovereignty over the Malvinas is not negotiable. Everything else is negotiable. Argentina is, I stress, totally prepared to discuss at the negotiating table all aspects relating to this conflict, with the exception of sovereignty.
Colonel Menendez feels that the British government should learn some hard lessons from the loss of the destroyer.
Yo creo que esta mutua destrucción...
I believe that this mutual destruction exercise will or could make the British authorities realize how foolish the adventure into which they have launched their fleet really is. With these regrettable incidents, and I insist that the destruction is tantamount to war, it may well be that what has happened so far will make the British government understand and see sense. They must take into account that the Argentinians are in the Malvinas. They are there in the south and are totally decided. They will fight with everything they have for a cause they believe in, with absolute steadfastness.
Absolutamente decididos a jugarse el todo por el todo por una causa en la que creen con absoluta firmeza.
Argentina's generals can count on an effective propaganda effort to back up their campaign for the islands. Magdalena Ruiz Guinyasu is one of the capital's most popular radio presenters, a respected journalist who chairs two news shows a day, and who has thrown her full weight behind the government. Singing in the rain is Magdalena's theme tune, reflecting an approach to the news which is normally varied. But in this crisis, virtually every minute on the air is devoted to the military and diplomatic battle for the islands. This week, Magdalena had to report the sinkings of both the General Belgrano and then the Sheffield. The mood in the studio ranged from funereal gloom to renewed confidence. I asked her how she personally felt about Argentina's successful attack on the Sheffield.
One can be proud and one can be sad. That these are two things that goes very well together, because dignity sometimes is not happy. You see what I mean? You can feel very dignified and very sad at the same time.
But at this moment, it's for real now, isn't it? It is real war. Men have died, blood has been shed,
yes,
on both sides. Do you still, as an Argentine, still want to go on with this to the end?
If it's necessary, yes.
Como para poder enfrentar circunstancias que...
Magdalena doesn't just report the news, she comments on it as well. And each program now ends with a personal statement, often a quiet appeal to her listeners' patriotism and determination in Argentina's hour of crisis. As the commuters of Buenos Aires return home, they hear Magdalena on their car radios, telling them that the cause is just. It's a voice that's become identified with Argentina's war.
My feeling in this moment is that our dignity and our interest is in to be all together and to go on. We cannot stop. We have reached the point of no return.
The military government can now count on tremendous support on the home front. But as a visit to any major bank reveals, there's a lingering worry about the state of the economy. For years, successive military governments have struggled to control the value of the peso. But inflation is still running at 80% a year. And the million peso note is something that Argentinians have had to learn to live with. Now, rigorous exchange controls have been introduced, making it virtually impossible to get hold of dollars legally. And this week, the government had to devalue the peso. The situation is far from disastrous, but it is unstable. And the government is known to be planning for a war economy. When Argentina's captains of industry held an emergency meeting to discuss the crisis, it was Jacques Hirsch, the chemical magnate, who took the chair. He, like the others, is angered by the sanctions imposed by Britain and the common market, which are likely to disrupt the supply of some imports. But Mr. Hirsch and his colleagues insist that the islands are worth paying an economic price for, and that Argentine industry will continue to function more or less normally, whatever measures Mrs. Thatcher may choose to take.
If Mrs. Thatcher believes that by the economic sanctions Argentina will yield, I am afraid the Prime Minister is wrong, because Argentina will not yield under these pressures.
No! 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 The 20,000 cattle that are sold daily at the stockyard in Buenos Aires are proof enough of the underlying wealth of this country and its ability, if necessary, to withstand economic siege. Argentina's prosperity is to a large extent built on pure beef. The vast herds of cattle that are raised on the pampas and then either slaughtered for home consumption or exported. Argentina has other natural resources. Self-sufficiency in oil is one of them. But it's the tremendous power of her agriculture that keeps the country afloat and even provides her with a certain economic leverage in this crisis. Mm-hmm. 70% of Argentina's agricultural exports now go to the Soviet Union. It's an astonishing trade balance that British officials have had to take account of. And people like Jacques Hirsch warn that if Britain keeps up the pressure, there may be further important changes in the pattern of world trade.
I believe the experience of the past shows that when a situation like the present arises, commercial links are established around the world, and the world will not be the same afterwards than it was before. So probably part of the commerce which traditionally was performed with the UK will go through other channels and through other sources, which will develop during this crisis. Oh!
In a rare display of unity, Argentina's trades unions have also come out in full support of the military government. And the strength of their feelings about the Falklands was shown by a demonstration which the government decided to permit on the eve of May Day. For years, Argentine industry has been damaged by tension between the military government, seeking to establish what it sees as order and discipline, and the trades unions, whose members are mainly followers of the dead populist leader, Juan Perón. The government had authorized the demonstrators to lay wreaths at a workers' monument, and this was done in a frenzy of enthusiasm. The trades unionists were not supposed to shout political slogans or distribute pamphlets, but both these orders were soon ignored in the first public display that the union had been permitted in months. The Peronist chants showed that the workers have not forgotten their old loyalties, but they have a new loyalty now, hanging on to the Falkland Islands. The demonstration also provided a rare glimpse of the secret powers of the state and the organization it relies on when popularity is not enough. As the demonstrators left, Secret Service agents emerged from parked cars and, without taking any trouble to conceal themselves, began a meticulous job of checking the political debris of the demonstration. One man even noted the names of people who had contributed the wreaths which had been laid at the monument. Others busied themselves trying to identify individual demonstrators or collecting examples of the political literature scattered all over the square. Even the banners the demonstrators had carried were taken away for examination. There was no mistaking the message, and the secret police made no attempt to hide it. They finally left in their Ford Falcon, a car which has become a feared trademark of the Argentine security forces, and no one in the square was left in any doubt as to where the limits of this newfound freedom lay. On February the 4th this year, Ana Maria was kidnapped outside her home in a poor district of Buenos Aires. She was a known left-winger. The girl, who was 3 months pregnant, was seized as she walked down the street and driven off at high speed in an unmarked Ford Falcon car.
Ana Maria's body was found 8 days later, dumped in open ground just a short distance away from a local naval headquarters. She had died of 2 bullet wounds, one in the stomach, the other in the head.
Virginia Marconi is a member of the same banned left-wing party as the dead girl. They've lost more than 70 members, dead or disappeared. But today, all that has been put aside.
The feeling that we have is that in this situation, we are in the military field with a military government, not in the political field. In the political field, we still are enemies of this government. But at this moment, you are invading us, and it's the United States and it's Great Britain invading our country. And that's what we are not going to allow, because our first position is to be next to our people fighting against a foreign invasion.
The true difficulty that Mrs. Thatcher faces is not just that she is confronting a well-trained and well-equipped army, but that the army in question is the mechanism that controls the state. And it's an army that is now determined to restore its honor and reputation at all costs. All Argentines I've spoken to would rather have peace than war, but not peace at any price.
How will you feel, sir, if the escalation of this conflict goes on, if more British ships come down here, more men, and Mrs. Thatcher is forced to become committed to an all-out military confrontation? What would be your feelings then?
It's a possibility we can't, of course, discount. But it's extremely important to realize that whatever difficulties the Argentinians might have to face them they will. If more ships come down here, more troops, then we'll stand up to those troops and stand up to those ships.
Julian Manyon reporting from Buenos Aires, and firm indication there that whatever may or may not be going on within the privacy of diplomatic circles, in public, Argentina believes that the principle, and in this case their principle, is worth the price. And by the way, Argentina tonight would make no comment on France's PIM statement that the Peruvian peace plan has collapsed. Well, now we turn to Europe. And where does the EEC stand? Well, when the invasion happened, all of Western Europe rallied to our support with economic sanctions. And today, the NATO defense ministers confirmed their broad support for Mrs. Thatcher's resolution. In between, tragically, there have been those deaths. And the deaths have led to some serious rethinking in European capitals. In broadest outline, Italy, Belgium, Holland and Greece are still wholeheartedly behind Britain. France, Denmark and Luxembourg are developing doubts. But two countries are now very critical. Ireland, the first to break ranks, has said enough is enough and asked for a further meeting of the UN Security Council. In Bonn, I asked Mr. Carsten Vogt, Member of Parliament and Foreign Affairs spokesman for Chancellor Schmidt's ruling party, why Germany is now worried.
I do think it's still in the memory and in the mind of the German people that it was Argentine who attacked the Falklands, and that we still have a feeling of solidarity with the British democracy against this Argentine dictatorship attacking the Falkland Island. And it's now a mood which more and more is harmed by the loss of people during the military events at the Falkland Islands.
What's the feeling in Germany about what Britain should do now? And is there a feeling that there is a role to be played by Germany and by its EEC partners?
I do think that it is, first of all, needed to take any possibility which is possible to try to get a political solution on the basis of the UN resolution and with the assistance of the United Nations. And I do think it's a very helpful if the European community and the single European countries make it clear to the other Latin American countries that this is not a conflict between Europe and Latin America, but this is a conflict in a situation where Argentine tried to solve a political conflict about the Falkland Islands, not by political means, but they started to solve it, if one could call that to solve it, by a military attack. And this is to try to get this understood by Latin American people, I do think is very important. And in so far as we can help to get a political solution for the whole conflict, we will try to do it. But naturally, we will do it and try to do it with in a process of consultation with our British friends.
Whatever doubts you may have about the increasing use of military strength in the South Atlantic, does Germany still, in the main, support Britain's attitude on this issue?
You see, our support for the British attitude was a support against military aggression, and it was a support in favor of a political solution, and it was a support in favor of a political democracy. And in so far as Britain tries to give the priority to a political solution and tries to get the support of the United Nations and act on the basis of the UN resolution, I do think we will continue with our solidarity with the British.
The German view. But the center of international diplomatic activity is now America, with a flurry of activity today over two peace plans. In Washington, for TVI, Peter Gill.
Government sources in Washington have just confirmed to me that the Hague Peace Initiative has indeed reached the end of the road. U.S. officials are now content to see the United Nations take the major peace role, but they are emphatic that they will be backing Britain at the UN. I'm told that the United States will support Britain in demanding an Argentinian withdrawal from the Falklands if there is to be any ceasefire. There is also another major implication of the collapse of the U.S.-Peruvian initiative. Government officials say that the Americans are going to be all the more receptive to requests from Britain for military assistance in the South Atlantic.
With me here in Washington, I have Frank Church, former chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and a firm supporter of the British position, and L. Francis Boucher, a leading Latin American expert who has been following developments in the South Atlantic from that point of view. Senator Church, to start with you, the British say they're combating aggression in the South Atlantic. Do you think that's a principle worth defending?
Well, it's been the centerpiece of American foreign policy to oppose aggression wherever it may occur. It's a founding principle of the United Nations Charter. How could my government oppose aggression in other places and take a different view in the case of the Falkland Islands? I really think that had Britain knuckled under and permitted her own subjects to be subjugated by a foreign army, we would be saying in this country that the British had lost their will to fight. And if they would not, under these circumstances, stand up against Argentina, how could we count upon them to stand up against the Soviet Union?
How far should we be prepared to go in compromise, do you feel?
Well, I think this is an issue that is susceptible to negotiation. And I believe that in light of the loss of two major naval vessels, one on either side, the two governments may be more susceptible to reopening talks. And the United States should do all that it can. The United Nations is another possible forum where these talks can now go forward.
Mr. Boucher, Mrs. Thatcher reiterates that the rights of the Falkland Islanders are paramount in this dispute. Do you regard that as a reasonable position to adopt?
No, I don't, and I think that this gravely complicated the prospect for settlement from the outset. Great powers such as Britain, the United States, Argentina, cannot allow their fates and the fate of peace to be decided by 1,800 residents. Their interest has to be considered, but there are many other solutions to protect their interests aside from allowing them to veto the ultimate transfer of sovereignty to the Argentine.
With her position, though, based on these principles, what do you feel Britain should now do?
I think the first thing Britain should do is pursue the initiative suggested this morning in the Washington Post by former Undersecretary of State William Rogers, and that is to quit claim or renounce any pretense to sovereignty over the islands, much in the same fashion that the United Kingdom did in the case of Belize and Guyana, and clearly leaving the transfer of sovereignty to the Argentines open, and simultaneously one could work out a self-governing formula for the residents there.
Senator Church, do you think we should retreat on this sovereignty question?
Well, I think that Britain is no longer in the empire business, and 2 years ago made an offer, a proposition that would have relinquished sovereignty in return for a lease back that would permit a decent interval for the necessary protection of the rights of those who live on the island and giving them the chance to make their own adjustments. That was rejected by the islanders. Under today's conditions, the islanders may take a different view. But I would not downgrade the principles at stake here. Self-determination is a very important principle, even though the islands are small. And I don't join with those who say, because there are just a few people involved, this is unworthy. The principles, the opposition to aggression as a means for settling international disputes, the recognition of self-determination are very important principles indeed. And any self-respecting government is not going to set them aside easily.
In TVI's opinion poll, we asked the British public today what they thought the government should do. The question was, now that lives have been lost, what should the government do? Continue with military operations, said 41%. Withdraw British troops, said 6%. Seek an immediate ceasefire, said 51%. So a majority, narrow though it is, for an immediate ceasefire. Well, for TVI, Brian Gould went down to Portsmouth.
HMS Victory, yesterday, as for the past 170 years, reminding Portsmouth of a long and glorious naval tradition. But yesterday, for the people of Portsmouth, was a day when the outcome of another naval battle gripped the city. The news of naval disaster hit harder here than anywhere else. For Portsmouth, the casualty figures weren't just statistics. They were husbands, fathers, sons, whose families were left behind when the Sheffield sailed. The wait for news was most painful on the naval estates which ring the city. Many of those on estates like this have menfolk in the task force. The fleet set sail from Portsmouth a month ago, carrying with it the good wishes and high hopes of the people of the city.
I think a lot of people thought it was great. You know, they were going off, we're going to show them and all this sort of business. And we did do for the first week. And then they hit back.
But at Radio Victory, Portsmouth's local radio station, the mood was still hawkish. In a specially arranged phone-in, most callers were clear about what they wanted to happen. Sir Lancelot Bell Davis, ex-NATO commander...
If we back away from the Falkland problem, then gosh knows, when do we stop backing away? And I think it is absolutely fundamental that if, as a democracy, we're going to live by the rule of law, then we have a responsibility and a duty to the world, as well as ourselves, to uphold that law and to enforce it. And the law has been broken by Argentina.
In the wake of the disaster, it was to the city's churchmen that many turned for comfort. But the Reverend Martin Morgan believes that the church's involvement should go beyond pastoral care.
I don't believe, as a Christian, that you can ever really countenance the use of force. I think until the diplomatic endeavours had really run their course, there just isn't any way that force makes any sense.
But wasn't there a clear issue here of right and wrong in which it's perfectly justifiable to use some degree of force?
I don't necessarily agree that when you have an issue of right or wrong, that force is the answer. The thought that one man can kill another just appalls me.
The rector of Rauna has 12,000 parishioners with direct naval connections. He spent his day comforting stricken relatives. How had he justified the use of force to those who'd been bereaved?
Well, the grounds for the Christian, I feel, would be the defence of those who are unable to defend themselves. And if loss of life is involved in that, well, then perhaps, to some extent, it becomes justified.
But how high a price would you think it right to pay for the defence of those principles?
Every life lost, in some ways, is too high. And yet we have seen before that lives do have to be lost to defend the right of the majority to be free.
Would you expect the sinking of the Sheffield to lead more people to move closer to your view of things?
I think that the awful tragedy of the sinking of the Sheffield will bring home to people, and particularly in an area like this, that in fact what is happening is real, and that they may well reconsider their attitude of having cheered the fleet out. They may now wonder whether in fact it was the right thing to do.
It's too early yet to think of memorials to those who die in the South Atlantic. But the people of Portsmouth know better than most that the price could be a heavy one.
Brian Gould in Portsmouth. Throughout the crisis, Mrs. Thatcher and the Tories have stood firm, and so far she's had public support. But the opinion polls, while firmly backing the sending of the task force, show that the public are obviously recoiling from the thought of lives being lost. We decided to test where opinion stands now. And the question, how do you rate Mrs. Thatcher's handling of the crisis? Very good, 38%. Fairly good, 29%. Not very good, 15%. Not good at all, 16%. So, in the main, public support for the Prime Minister's firmness of purpose. And now we rejoin Llew Gardner and the politicians. Llew.
Gentlemen, can we discuss the issue, is there a price to principle? And may I remind you of the words yesterday of Peter Jenkins writing in The Guardian. Referring to the deaths and the sinkings of ships, he said, already the means to the end are disproportionate. So, Anthony, do you agree with that?
When the force was dispatched, a vast majority of the people in this country approved of that being done. Now, to find a small majority disapproving of it being used indicates a certain lack of logic, I think you'll agree. Now the poll, you tell us, that says that we should seek an immediate ceasefire and ask the United Nations to mediate. That's exactly, in effect, what we're doing. We're trying to get a ceasefire and trying to get someone to mediate, the United Nations if necessary. What has to be asked after is what the conditions should be after the ceasefire. And if there be no other conditions than a ceasefire, that is merely handing the islands over with all the vacation of any principle for which we started out.
I'm not quite sure, Sir Anthony, that you addressed yourself entirely to my question. Is there a limit to the price we pay for this principle? How many deaths?
You mean a military limit?
Yes.
Yes, of course.
A sacrifice limit?
Yes, there's an obvious limit which has to be observed. In the case of the Falkland Islands, I would say that operations round the Falkland Islands are something that we can envisage and something which ought to be pressed. But I personally would not support an attack on the Argentinian mainland. I think the political and indeed perhaps the moral price for that would be too great.
Denis Healey, have we passed the point of sacrifice, or are there more sacrifices still to come that would be correct to make in this cause?
I think it depends very much on the situation. I think the government itself has made clear from the beginning it doesn't seek a solution by military force, but wants to use force to back up diplomacy. We have an opportunity now to go to the United Nations. The Argentinians have agreed to accept the Secretary General as a go-between, especially now that the Hague Initiative has finally collapsed, according to your reporters this evening, and I think the really urgent thing is to do that now. I personally wish we'd done it a week or two earlier, and then just possibly we might have avoided one or two of the tragedies of the last few days. But there is obviously a price too great. You asked me to put a number on it. That, of course, is quite impossible. It depends on how the Argentines behave, whether they attack us. But I would say I don't believe a long and bloody campaign would be justified, to use the words of the force commander, and I don't think it would be right to undertake operations which led to the loss of more British and Argentinian lives than there are inhabitants on the Falkland Islands. But beyond that, I think it's very, very difficult to draw a line.
We had news today, for instance, from the Minister of Defence saying that action was being pursued still to enforce the exclusion zone. Are they correct to be doing that? And if that involves further sinking, are they correct to be doing that?
Well, I think it depends on the precise circumstances. I was unhappy, as I made clear in Parliament and also on television, with the sinking of the Argentine cruiser. And I think one problem is, we discussed this the other day, David Owen and I on another programme, that if you use weapons intended for all-out attack in a global war, to try to use economy of force in a police action, you run into very great difficulties, especially if technical factors like the difficulty of communicating with submarines make it impossible to exercise continuous political control. And I think we have been on the verge recently of going beyond the point at which we're contributing to negotiations and at which the force used is proportionate according to international convention and indeed moral law, with the importance of the issue at stake.
David Owen, we listen to that young wife down there in Portsmouth. She already seems sick of it, already seems to think that the game isn't worth the candle. Isn't that feeling going to grow if there are more deaths?
I think it will grow with the wives of servicemen, but there's another side to it. I was in Plymouth, and there are many Plymouthians down in the southern Atlantic, and I talked to wives of Marines and naval people last night. And there was another side of the story which has to be said. They all were saying to me, we've lost these lives, we want to make sure that they didn't die in vain. And I think there is also a resolution underneath all of this. I think the government has got to carry the public with them. If the public feels that the government is making every reasonable attempt to achieve a genuinely negotiated solution, I think they will still maintain support for the continuation of the task force and the continuation of the exclusion zone. And I don't exclude that the country would also support a repossession of some part of the Falkland Islands. I think they wouldn't like a bloody invasion of Port Stanley with all the dangers that would be to Falkland Islanders. I think, therefore, one must not get into the habit now of saying that because of a loss of life, there is a sort of complete backing off the use of force in Britain. I don't think that's the case, but it's contingent. It is contingent on feeling that we are being flexible in our negotiating position. I personally think that the government will now have to show what, if you like, is their bottom line and negotiating position. And I think that this issue of sovereignty has got to be grappled with a bit more honestly by members of the House of Commons. I personally think we ought to offer to have the Falkland Islands made a trusteeship. In effect, that sort of sidesteps the issue of sovereignty. The administration could remain with Britain if we could reach agreement, which would be far preferable. And I do think at the moment the government hasn't revealed what its negotiating hand is. I mean, Denis Healey said this. And you see, the Argentinians have rejected the initial Hague proposal. They've rejected now the Peruvian proposal. If it goes to the UN, the diplomacy is going to be very much more public. That's the very nature of UN diplomacy. And I personally think that there is something to be said for Britain revealing to the world what its negotiating stance, which is part of Resolution 502.
I know Denis Healey wants to come in, but I think I'll better put that straight away to Sir Anthony.
On the sovereignty,
question. We were negotiating about sovereignty and have been for some time. This is clear, therefore, that this is something which, as far as we're concerned, is on the table. Not so, of course, with the Argentinians. As far as I'm concerned...
Would you accept his trusteeship?
Yes, as far as I'm concerned, I would accept, therefore, some kind of trusteeship in the future, if it could be properly arranged and properly secured without the danger of further Argentinian interventions. On the thing that would be very difficult for me to accept would be the administration, that's to say the occupation of the islands to continue in Argentine hands. That, I feel, would be a very, very difficult thing to accept.
Denis Healey.
I think the problem which is approaching us very, very fast, which makes your earlier question even more difficult to answer, is this, that it's pretty clear the government is prepared to negotiate a transfer of sovereignty. Indeed, it has offered that in the past. This is the one thing the Argentines really want. They've made it clear they're not so worried about whether they keep their troops on the islands, providing we concede sovereignty. And Mrs. Thatcher has very reasonably said so far she's not prepared to concede sovereignty before the negotiations start. Now, I think, however, if in the end the argument Tony Kershaw had this with me the other day is that we won't let the burglar take his swag out of the front door, but if he goes round to the back door, we'll see that the United Nations hands it to him. Then I think the number of lives which the public will feel it's reasonable to lose in order to create an interval will diminish very sharply.
Well, it's precisely that point. I will come to you, Sir Anthony, because I wanted to pick that up. I mean, David Owen said they want to see that people don't die in vain. But by the very nature of agreeing to negotiations, don't we go down the road to Argentine sovereignty, because there's nothing else in the last analysis to negotiate? And isn't it, even if they withdraw and the ships all go home, 2-3 years' time, they're going to have their sovereignty, aren't they? And won't they then have died in vain?
Well, we must have some sort of guarantees that that won't happen, some verification, so to speak. If this sovereignty, transfer of sovereignty, means transfer to Argentina solely, I couldn't agree to that. But what David has just said, that to a trusteeship of the United Nations, that is something, I think, which we could back.
The advantage of trusteeship is that neither side has sovereignty. It is neither British nor Argentinian. It goes to the United Nations. It goes to an international... Well, you might say that this is what you put forward for the interim solution. It may then be that, as so often in life, the interim becomes the permanent. And I think that it may be very difficult for the Argentinians to accept that the trusteeship is permanent, because that would mean forsaking their long-term claim, and it may be difficult even for Britain to accept that that is the permanent solution. But it goes for the interim, and it could well be the permanent situation. There will be a problem about who administers it. It is possible, of course, to have some shared administration. We've never yet heard from the British government whether they accepted the three-flag situation, which was the American, British and
I think that, with respect to David, I think he's confusing two separate things. When I discussed this with the Secretary General, he made it clear that the United Nations will be very glad to provide a temporary administration on the islands and, if necessary, a police force during the transitional period when Britain was negotiating the ultimate solution with the Argentine. Now, trusteeship could provide the ultimate solution. UN administration is not trusteeship. The problem with trusteeship is the UN has to decide who exercises it on behalf of the United Nations. And of course, in the past, it's usually been the country which hands it over. And this is an area where I think there may be some difficulty with the Argentines, but I believe we would get much more support in the world if we made it clear that for our part, we are prepared to ask the UN to take over temporary administration and then propose a permanent trusteeship. But whether in the end we will get the Argentines to agree that, I think, is another matter.
But the first question is, let's face it, we mustn't get round it, is the question of the withdrawal. And what we're going to face in the next few days is growing world demand for a simple ceasefire. And I think we've got to be quite clear about that. A ceasefire which leaves the Argentinians on the Falkland Islands and means that our ships are just sort of sailing around is not something that is acceptable. We've got to have a ceasefire linked to a phased withdrawal. And on this, I believe the government deserves the united support of the House of Commons. And so far, she seems to be having it. And that, I believe, will be very difficult for Britain, but it looks as if we would have the US with us, at least, if we had to veto it. And I hope we'd have France with us as well.
But isn't the truth, and I've come to you, Sir Anthony, isn't the truth that the world is beginning to get a bit tired of both parties, and perhaps of us? I saw the Washington Post 2 days ago saying there is no irreconcilable issue. There are only two governments stuck on the requirements of pride.
This was entirely to be anticipated, and was indeed anticipated. But, of course, we must not allow them to forget that the first thing that happened was that Argentina invaded the Falkland Islands, did a sort of Pearl Harbor on us, and now the cry is that we should deal with them on a trusting basis. It simply isn't on. I don't think the United States would have trusted the Japanese 1 month after Pearl Harbor, and I don't see why we should trust the Argentinians.
But could I say that the Secretary General has made it clear that he would like a ceasefire linked with the process for withdrawal of Argentine troops and of our task force, and this must be our absolute objective at this time. And the government has moved a little on this, because it has said now it is prepared to have the ceasefire first and then the process of withdrawal follow. It took a quite different line a week or two ago, and I believe this is the issue, I agree with David, on which the House of Commons is united and on which we must now concentrate in the United Nations, because we've no more time to lose.
Let me come back to where we started, gentlemen, and in the last minute. Let me ask each one of you again. We called this programme The Price of Principle. I ask each of you again at the end of the programme, briefly, is there a price that is too high for the principle at stake? Denis Healey.
Well, of course there is. We don't want a nuclear war over this. We don't want an all-out war between Britain and the Argentine.
David Owen.
Of course, there could not be a nuclear war. We are not allowed to use nuclear weapons against a non-nuclear weapon state.
But the war that we're fighting.
There is a price that is worth paying, and there is obviously a price that is not. We haven't yet reached the situation in which that is a real question, and I think we are, if I may say so, falling into a great trap here. We are in a democracy. We can have all these opinion polls. But I think you're underestimating the resolve of the British people.
I must go quickly to Sorrento.
We can't say in black and white exactly what the price should be, but clearly we must be ready to negotiate at any time, and if we're understood to be that, then we can be confident the outcome, I think.
Gentlemen, thank you very much indeed.
From Buenos Aires tonight, Julian Manyon tells us that there is no surprise at the British announcement of the collapse of the so-called Peruvian Hague Plan, the reason that the plan wanted to take the wishes of the islanders into account. The Argentinians repeat their claim that they will not accept anything unless it gives a guarantee of eventual sovereignty. So attention now turns to the other plan in the news, the UN plan, and no one yet knows what the final price of principle will be. From TVI, good night.